Hey everybody, James Moore here, J&J on Jazz, powered by JazzWire, bringing you a guided listening session. I am on the road right now, coming to you from a very interesting hotel room in Florida. It's kind of funky, which fits because the recording we're going to check out this week, another of my favorite cuts from the great Hank Mobley album Soul Station, Dig Dis, which is kind of funky. So we've got Hank Mobley on tenor saxophone, Wynton Kelly on piano, Paul Chambers on bass, Art Blakey on drums, the seminal quartet record. So here is Dig Dis. So let's listen to a few choruses and just see if you can identify the form. You probably already have. So we're dealing with a minor blues, right? Kinda, sorta. It's a 12-bar form. Okay. Nice little two-chorus intro there by Wynton Kelly. What a simple melody here. It doesn't go to the minor 4 chord in the 5th bar. Listen for that. So we're in B-flat minor. That's F-sharp 7 is where it goes. Yes, that's where it goes. Now, check out the stop time here. Hank was the master at using space and letting stop time and break figures really propel his lines. Another chorus of stop time. Stretches the time out there. And he's just singing. Here comes the Art Blakey press roll. So really, now we're just playing the blues. Really listen to the way Hank plays the 8th bar, every chorus. He plays very similar ideas in that 8th bar. It's the real connective tissue of the harmony of the blues. And he makes it every time. And I love the way Art Blakey's playing this just real simple, relentless shuffle. Wynton Kelly very busy. They're really propelling Hank right here. Yes. Those three cymbal hits, man, that's like kicking into overdrive. That's the first time he's played any double time. He's very thematic in this solo. And very melismatic too. It's a masterpiece in building intensity over the long haul. Hank was so adept at that, particularly on a blues. Now, I talk about this a lot. Like, stuff gets really interesting behind the piano players. And I love how Art Blakey is swinging so intensely on that ride cymbal, but it's so quiet. You have to remember that these cats had to play with a different kind of approach to dynamics than we do. Recording technology wasn't what it is today. They had to control the dynamics in real time on stage and in a recording session. Getting that real thick cross stick from Boo. And also, really lean into, like, listening to Paul Chambers. You can hear his open string work. It's almost like Art Blakey's left hand on the cross stick is louder than anything else. So much blues, right? What I love about this record is that if you listen to Wynton Kelly's feel and Hank Mobley's feel, they're very similar. We're gonna listen to this whole thing again, like we do with these short little tunes. We'll give you two passes. Again, dynamics. We play much louder than these musicians played. Did you hear that crescendo that we had there? Okay, a lot going on there. Pardon my allergies. I'm coming from the north down to the south. My body's a mess right now. This is giving me life, though. What a masterpiece in pacing in terms of Hank's solo and the intensity that he uses that he builds through his solo, right? And really witness the way that the rhythm section is totally, totally in tune with that. And in many ways, I've said this before, they're like the encouraging hand on the small of his back, just pushing him along. You can tell I'm in a hotel room because there's like the light coming from the... Right. They're the hand that pushes him along and really encourages him and anticipates his energy. Also, he doesn't play double time until 6, 7, 8 choruses in. Really judicious. I would be playing double time 2 or 3 or 4 choruses in because it's fun, and I use it as a crutch. Hank was very disciplined. So when we listen back through again this next time, I want you to think of a couple things. Recognize that Hank is a very disciplined, present soloist. Very thematic. He repeats a lot of ideas. He plays similar ideas in the 8th bar of the blues almost every time. And when he repeats himself, it's for good reason. When you listen to Wynton Kelly, I want you to listen to his phrase length, but also his feel and how bouncy his feel is and how the dynamics that the entire band plays with, they change from Hank Mobley to Wynton Kelly. So we're going to listen to it again. Here we go. I'm pretty sure this is... It's F-sharp 7 in the 4th bar for this intro and for the melody. You can hear the roots of Ron Carter in Paul Chambers. Ooh, and Paul Chambers totally caught on to Wynton's that little bugle call thing that he did. You could totally hear Paul Chambers catching that. Listen to the hits in the kick drum. They're locked in. Remember that these blue note dates, these cats got to rehearse before the record session. The blue note label would pay for rehearsals, so these were tight record dates. Plus, these guys played music together all the time. Way more than we get to. Okay, listen to the way that Hank uses the breaks to breathe. He doesn't play over one of them. He doesn't play through any of the breaks. Almost. Again, the press roll to nowhere. There's no crash at the end. So now, when you hear Hank play over just the regular swingin' blues, when he breathes, I want you to imagine that there's a break there. Beat up. Beat up. You can put breaks into his breaths. Yeah, and that shuffle it slowly materializes and starts to gather steam, right? Yeah. You hope that when you're playing with a drummer, that he or she will give you that at the top of a chorus. Bang, 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 when you need that extra push. Even with the double time, he's leaving space at the end of those lines, right? Yeah, his space is masterful. And once he gets into these later choruses, there's lots of double time happening, but it doesn't sound gratuitous, at least not to me. He likes to end, he uses that to end chorus and solos a lot. Ooh, that's great, man. Okay, listen how bouncy the fill is. It's almost like leans towards the dotted 8/16th, but not in a corny way. He really swings his eighth notes. Nat Adderley swung his eighth notes that way too, the great cornetist brother of Cannonball Adderley. I love this quiet intensity where the loudest thing is the cross stick. Wynton Kelly's double time is great to learn because it's super clean, it's easy to hear, and it's easy to hear. Like with some cats, it can be a little slippery. It's very precise with Wynton Kelly. You can almost see him pushing down the keys. Listen to the dynamics they use in the melody on the way out. The melody is not a throwaway. A lot of times, cats just don't care about the melody. But the tune is still going. Just because we're done soloing doesn't mean the fun's over. Ooh, that's so nice. So tight, so tight. No question how we end it. A well-rehearsed recording session. Wow. So dig this from Hank Mobley's seminal recording Soul Station. Hank Mobley on tenor saxophone, Wynton Kelly on piano, Art Blakey on drums, Paul Chambers on bass. Coming to you from a funky hotel room in Florida. I'm telling you, this is a great one to listen to over and over and over. And I didn't want to talk too much because there are such little subtle things in all the tunes on this record, but particularly this tune. So it's also a great one to play with, to use in place of a play-along track, like instead of using an Abersold or or I Real B or Band in a Box. Like, blow, like, practice playing concert B flat blues over this recording. Try to match Hank and Wynton's phrasing. Think about those breaks. You want a lesson in how to play over breaks? Just solo over those first two choruses where it's just nothing but breaks for Hank, and learn what he plays, and then use it as a way to improvise yourself and start to figure out your way how to play through breaks like that. That's something that I still struggle with too. I overplay and I don't leave enough space when breaks are being used. It's also a great reminder that we should all want to play in bands that are tight, that rehearse. It's nice to be spontaneous. We love that. But it's also really nice to play with a tight group of musicians that are well rehearsed. So I could go on and on about this recording, but just my main takeaways: Hank's phrasing, even when there aren't breaks happening, you can hear that breaks could fit in there. Such a judicious use of space and pacing. The double time doesn't show up till 7 or 8 or 9 choruses in, and it's just a really amazing example of building an intense solo over multiple choruses. And then Wynton Kelly, the feel that he plays with, we should all learn to cop that feel. Dynamics, dynamics, dynamics. Hey, listen, Jeff and I are excited to be back with everybody for full-blown J&J on Jazz. We've had a bit of a hiatus for a million reasons, but we're looking forward to it, and we're looking forward to what used to be called Maryland Summer Jazz, and Jeff's given it a new name, and it's escaping me right now, but I bet that Matt will put a link to it right down here. If you're in JazzWire, you already know what it is. So if you're out there in the world, get behind the paywall and find out what's going on here at JazzWire. We want you to be able to check out all the great things that are happening in here. I've missed seeing everybody. I'm going to try to get in JazzWire and actually participate. It's been a wild couple months for me, I look forward to seeing you all this summer so I can fill you in on all the craziness. Take care. Keep swinging. I'm going to go walk on the beach. Later.